one set as a flame with brilliant color. Gifts beneath a lighted tree. Friends around the holiday table. Families reunited in love. Church bells ringing. This is Christmas in America. Though similar to Christmas celebrations in other countries, America has its own rich treasures of custom and tradition, woven into a pattern with our own country's threads, giving to us the colorful pageantry and deep meaning of our Christmas celebration.
Thank you.
universal feature of Christmas is the use of evergreens in churches and homes. Among ancient Romans, evergreens were an emblem of peace, joy, and victory. Early Christians placed greens in their windows to indicate that Christ had victoriously entered their home. Holly and ivy, along with pine and fir, were evergreen, ever alive, even in the midst of winter. They symbolize the unchanging nature of God, and they remind us of the everlasting life that is ours through Christ. In Isaiah 60:13, we find these words: "The glory of Lebanon shall come unto you, the fir tree, the pine tree, and the box together, to beautify the place of your sanctuary." Our forebears called the procuring of these evergreens, bringing home Christmas.
Advent is a time of expectation, and this is symbolized not only by the four-week period of preparation, but also by the lighting of a candle in the Advent wreath on each Sunday of the season. The flame of each new candle reminds us that something is happening, and something more is still to come. The candles are arranged in a circle to remind us of the continuous love of God, which knows neither beginning nor ending. There's also symbolism in the colors of the candles. The three blue candles symbolize the coming of Christ from the royal line of David. Christ is coming as the King of Kings as well as the Prince of Peace. The pink candle, which is lighted on the third Sunday of Advent, represents our joy. The large white candle in the center is known as the Christ candle and points to Jesus as the Christ, the light of the world. Each candle symbolizes various aspects of our waiting experience. The culmination of the season comes as we light the Christ candle on Christmas Eve and rejoice that the promise of long ago has been fulfilled. And we welcome the Thompson family to light our candle this week. And the mic is there.
People of God, prophets point into a future hope, a Savior. No one knew when he would come. They only hoped they would recognize the Messiah, the Son of God. We wait with hope for the one who will come and is coming. Today we light a candle to symbolize our hope. We hope for the one who will come. People of God, a new hope will come. We will rejoice in the Lord.
Thank you.
pastor said was, if you sit down and behave, when I'm done, you get a candy cane. See how well that works? Sometimes it works, folks. And so when they were done, the priest gave everybody candy canes. Now when they first came to the United States in the 1800s, they were still sticks, but people wanted to hang them on their tree. And so they started being shaped like this.
Thank you.
goodwill to all people. Let us sing Hark the Herald.
Joel Robert Poinsett. first introduced it to the United States in 1828. The people of Mexico and Central America called the brilliant tropical plant the flower of the holy night. The poinsettia is a many-pointed star that has become a symbol of the star of Bethlehem. And I invite you to stand, if you are able, as we affirm our faith together. In spite of the thousand unanswered questions, and in the face of the pervading sense of cynicism, God of grace, we believe. We believe that you are with us in history, bringing liberty to the oppressed and salvation to the lost. We believe that you chose nations and people to receive your life and to share. We believe that in the face of Messiah, Jesus, your life shines with an inextinguishable grace. We believe that all your hopes rest in Him, and that one day they will be all fulfilled. We believe that your Christ continues with us, and that nothing done in His name can ever be lost. In spite of a thousand unanswered questions, in the face of the great secular cynicism, God of grace, we believe.
So the shepherds went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. This is the word of God for the people of God. We jump into the story. The angels spoke to the shepherds in the field, these men of low esteem, of disrepute. Did you know that shepherds weren't even allowed to testify for someone in court because they were notorious liars? No one believed anything they said, so they weren't even allowed in court. But that's the angels came to. And what the shepherds did was they left immediately. They heard what the angels said and took off. They believed and they left even their responsibilities to go find the child so that they could worship him. And sometimes we think that the worship they did was the bowing down and the kneeling, but what the worship they actually did was the telling as they left that place. As we go into our Advent conspiracy, one of the things I'd like us to consider is, what story of Christmas are we telling this year? Because there are now two stories that express Christmas. We have a secular story, and we have a church story. The secular story is told starting on Black Friday. It's told by people giving up time with the family on Thanksgiving to set up the stores. People giving up time with their family on Thanksgiving to camp out in front of the stores. So that at whatever time the doors open, they can push and shove, bash others over the head. Give me that Wii, give me that PlayStation 3. Trampling others so that they can get the best bargain. And it's a story truly of love. People don't wait in lines like that, usually for themselves. People push and shove because they want to get that best gift for their son or daughter or their child. I've even heard of people shooting one another out of the love of getting the right gift. And certainly, we get obsessed with the right preparations. We spend lots of money to have people hanging lights on our house, so our house will be just right. We hire someone to help us clean, so we just right when the folks come in. And then we stress and stress over making sure that the party, the dinner will be just right. And by the time we get to that, we're so exhausted we just wish that the family would go home. That's one story of Christmas. And then there's the other story of Christmas. It's the story of worshiping the child with ourselves. It's the story that the shepherds said when they left the nativity. It's the story of wise men going across country on a perilous journey, facing a king and crossing a king in order to give to that needy family. It's the story of a young woman pregnant before she was married, saying, yes, I will hold this child. I will take the love of God within me. It's the story of a man who faced a lot of criticism for staying with a woman who was pregnant before marriage. But he said yes and stayed and cared for that child. It's the story of God saying, I love you so much, all I want to do is spend time with you. It's a story of love and presence, not with a TS, but with a CE. It's a being present with one another, not doing presence. And yes, I think it's a good thing to give presents, to give gifts. We can show our love by doing that. But when that takes precedence over being present with one another, sitting with one another, sitting in the quietude of God's presence, which is why God came in the first place, then we're telling the wrong story with our worship. How we spend this next 4 weeks tells us how we worship the God that came. We spend it back up in doing Christmas. We tell one story. But if we spend it more in being with one another, with God, with the needy, with the homeless, in relationship with one another, even with a family member who we really wish would come home, maybe especially spending it with a family member who we really wish would come home, and making a new connection. That's worshiping. Doesn't even seem to matter, doesn't even pray anymore. But they came to be with us. We worship fully when we take the time to be with them. That's the Advent experience. It's finding a way to do differently this Christmas so that the Christ child can dwell differently in us this Christmas. Christmas are the stickers of Christ, Christ monograms. They are ways that, in simple, we can talk about who Christ is. They're white for purity and gold for royalty. One of the most recognizable is the Chi in the row, which is right here, which is the first two letters in the Greek word for Christ. Alpha and Omega. Christ is the beginning and the end. We have the orb of the cross, which stands for the King. We have the Lamb, the peace, the one who came for us. The cross, the butterfly. All these are symbols of the babe, the Christ, whom we are to worship. Are we worshiping?